Okay, so we will start the lecture here. You should understand what we mean by wrist. Now, if you take the upper limb, you have the arm or the upper arm, whatever you call it. Then you have the forearm. Then you have the hand. And here you have the shoulder joint. You have the elbow joint here. Then you have the wrist joint here. Then you have many joints here in the hand. You have intercarpal joints, carpal metacarpal joints, metacarpal phalangeal, interphalangeal, like that. All those joints are in the region of the hand. So here I said it's shoulder joint, elbow joint, and wrist joint. Now, wrist, when you say wrist, it's not merely the wrist joint. It is the area around the wrist joint. So it's the region of the wrist. And the region of the wrist, therefore, includes carpal bones. You have the carpal bones here. Then you have the distal end of the two forearm bones, radius and ulna. So that whole area is the region of the wrist. And in the region of the wrist, you will find in front and behind long flexor and extensor tendons, as well as the vessels and nerves. There are several arteries and veins and nerves passing through the region of the wrist. So that is one point. Then the second point is this region is a common site for injury. So clinically, therefore, it is important to know about this region. And since there are several nerves and blood vessels are passing through that area, when there is injury to that region, some of these structures can get damaged. So you can have fractures in this area, and you can have cut injuries, especially when you get cut injuries to the anterior aspect, you can get several nerves and vessels and even tendons. These long tendons can get damaged, especially due to cut injuries of the wrist, or any other soft tissue injury can take place. So the details of that, you know, we will not discuss here. Then if you look at the anterior aspect of the wrist, one important point that you need to remember is that in the area of the wrist, you get this tough fibrous tissue band, which is called the flexor retinaculum. Flexor retinaculum, so that is attached to the carpal bones. On the anterior side, in front or superficial, anterior or superficial to the flexor retinaculum, you get several structures. Now this one, now this is the medial side, because there is the little finger side, and this is the thumb side. So this is lateral side or radial side. You can call it either way. This is medial or ulnar side, and the other side is the lateral side. Now, you can see the ulnar nerve here, and you have the ulnar artery lateral to the ulnar nerve. Then there's another nerve further lateral to the artery, which is the palmar cutaneous branch of the ulnar nerve. So that has been given off before the beginning of the flexor retinaculum. Now, if this is your flexor retinaculum, if I draw it an anterior view, it is attached to carpal bones like this. We will see to which carpal bones it is attached later. If you take the ulnar nerve like this, this palmar cutaneous branch is given before the flexor retinaculum. Okay, so therefore it is a separate branch which is superficial to the flexor retinaculum. So that is what you see here. So in a way, the artery, ulnar artery, lies between the two nerves, the main nerve, the ulnar nerve, and the branch of the ulnar nerve, the palmar cutaneous branch. And that palmar cutaneous branch is the one that supplies the medial half of the palm, medial half of the skin of the medial palm, of the medial part of the palm. Then the other point that is important here is this particular section has been taken actually at the distal end of the flexor retinaculum. At the distal end of the flexor retinaculum. And because of that, you can see the bones here that are cutting cross-section, the carpal bones, are the distal row of carpal bones. you can cut through the flexor retinaculum at a proximal level here. Then you will see, instead of these four bones, you will see trapezium, scaphoid, lunate, then triquetral and pisiform. Those proximal row of carpal bones will be seen if you take the section proximally. And deep to the flexor retinaculum, there are several other structures. You can see the long flexor tendons. So these four tendons are flexor digitorum superficialis tendons, and these four tendons are flexor digitorum profundus tendons. That is deep to the flexor retinaculum. Then most important structure that is there is the median nerve. Median nerve lying deep to the flexor retinaculum. So that is clinically important. We'll get back to it later when we discuss the carpal tunnel here. So this area, this space formed by flexor retinaculum above and the carpal bones, flexor retinaculum anteriorly and the carpal bones posteriorly, is called the carpal tunnel. And we will get back to that topic later, maybe. Then I said this is flexor digitorum superficialis and these are flexor digitorum profundus tendons. And separately, you can see another tendon which is called the flexor pollicis longus. So that is going into the thumb, and it is attached to the base of the distal phalanx of the thumb. Then this one is called flexor carpi radialis. Okay, that is flexor carpi radialis. Then you would wonder where the flexor carpi ulnaris is. Coming back to the where I started, if this is your flexor retinaculum, this is your pisiform bone. So flexor carpi ulnaris is actually attached to the pisiform bone here, and therefore the nerve and the artery lie lateral to the flexor carpi ulnaris tendon here. So when you take the section distally, you will not see the flexor carpi ulnaris or the pisiform. That's why you don't see flexor carpi ulnaris here. But the flexor carpi radialis muscle, it's attached to the base of the second and third. It's not the fingers, actually the metacarpal bones, second and third metacarpal bones, base of that, so that you see it passing through even at the distal end of the flexor retinaculum. So that point you need to remember. And there's another point: since the section has been taken here, only you see this arrangement of long flexor tendons here. Now, for instance, if you take the section proximally, what you will see here, that the tendons will be arranged like this: two tendons above, two tendons below. Then you will get 1, 2, 3, 4 tendons. So these are then the flexor digitorum superficialis tendons, and this is flexor digitorum profundus tendons. So these two, the anterior two tendons in that case, would be the tendons going into the middle finger and the ring finger, and the posterior two tendons are going into the index finger and the little finger, small finger. Okay, but at the distal site, at that point, it changes, and the four tendons spread out and form this line of four tendons. So understand that as well. Then the other point that you can see here is, actually you get a lot of information from this diagram. You can see that these tendons, long flexor tendons, and for that matter even the extensor tendons, we'll come back to it, they are covered by this blue line, indicates synovial sheets. So you can see for flexor digitorum profundus and superficialis tendons, there's a common synovial sheath at the wrist. It's a common synovial sheath. So this is a common one. Okay, even though it's partly separated, it's a common synovial sheath. Then when it comes to flexor pollicis longus here, it has a separate synovial sheath. You can see it, separate synovial sheath. And even for flexor carpi radialis, you can see a synovial sheath here, very small one. So then that point is also important. So remember that point. Then going back to the posterior aspect of the wrist, that is behind the carpal bones, posterior to the carpal bones, just like you had flexor retinaculum here, the tough band, you have an extensor retinaculum. You have an extensor retinaculum on the posterior aspect of the wrist. And that extensor retinaculum actually holds the extensor tendons without allowing them to jut out during extension of the wrist joint. And that extensor retinaculum is attached to the underlying bones through several fibrous septa. You can see it here. And these fibrous septa divide that whole area under the extensor retinaculum into six compartments. If you count them from medial to lateral, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 compartments. Okay. And within these six compartments, you get the extensor muscles and certain other structures. Now, again, just like in the flexor retinaculum case, in the anterior side, in the posterior side, there are a few structures which are superficial to the extensor retinaculum. On the medial side, you can see a nerve here. This is the posterior cutaneous branch of the ulnar nerve, which is given off in the middle part of the forearm and which goes to the posterior side. Initially, it's from the anterior side, it comes to the posterior side. And then adjacent to it, you see a vein here, which is the basilic vein, that is, you know, mostly the beginning of the basilic vein from the dorsal venous arch in that area. So that is the basilic vein. Then laterally, on the lateral side, you have similarly the cephalic vein, and on either side of the cephalic vein, you get branches of the superficial branch of the radial nerve. Now in the elbow, at the elbow, if you have the arm and the forearm like this, at the level of the elbow, the radial nerve divides into a deep branch and a superficial branch. Deep branch becomes the posterior interosseous nerve later. The superficial branch is the one that divides into several branches and is seen here. So these structures, basilic vein, cephalic vein, the superficial branch of the radial nerve, and the posterior cutaneous branch of the ulnar nerve, they are all superficial to the extensor retinaculum. And deep to the extensor retinaculum, you get the long list of extensor tendons. I am not going to read out all the names of extensor tendons. You can read them out here. Then I will show you one thing. The radial artery, which is usually on the anterior side, but at this point, this is a distal point of cut. Then by that time, the radial artery has moved to the posterior side after winding around the radius. It's going to enter the thumb after some time. It will enter the thumb through the first gap between the thumb and the thumb metacarpal and the index finger metacarpal bone. So that is the thing I wanted to raise here at the wrist structures in relation to the wrist area. Then a few things about the flexor and extensor retinacula. They are a thickening of deep fascia over the carpal bones, and their function is to hold the flexor and extensor tendons in position without allowing them to jut out. Because the thing is, during flexion, the long flexor tendons tend to jut out if there is no band-like thing to hold them in position. Similarly, when you extend the wrist, and for that matter, even the fingers, when you extend them, if there is no structure that is there to hold them in position, then the extensor tendons will jut out. So that is prevented by the flexor and extensor retinacula. And when it comes to the attachment of the flexor retinaculum, as you can see here, it is attached to the scaphoid here, then trapezium in the distal row, then again the proximal row, pisiform, that is medially, and then the hamate. The exact point, if you ask to state the exact points, it is actually the tubercle of the scaphoid to which it is attached. Then there is a ridge on the trapezium. It is attached to the ridge on the trapezium and the hook of the hamate and the pisiform. Okay. So these are so laterally, it is the tubercle of the scaphoid and the ridge of the trapezium, and medially it is the hook of the hamate and the pisiform bones. So that is something that you can remember because it's not uncommon to do surgeries on this flexor retinaculum. It's a fairly common surgery. You cut this like this to relieve pressure from the carpal tunnel. We'll get back to it later. Then the extensor retinaculum, on the other hand, its lateral attachment is different to flexor retinaculum. The lateral attachment is to the distal end of the radius, as you can see here. Then the medial attachment is the same, hook of the hamate and the pisiform. Now, if you read different anatomy books, you will see different versions. Some anatomy books say that it is only attached to the pisiform. Some say that it is attached to the pisiform and the triquetral. And some say that it is attached to the pisiform and the hook of the hamate. So I'm going by Richard Snell, clinical anatomy book. So there, you know, you take it as the hook of the hamate and the pisiform. It's, in a way, it's easy because both are medially attached to the same bony points there. So so that is something that you can remember from this. Then a few more things about the flexor retinaculum. There are two tunnels formed within the flexor retinaculum, two tunnels formed within the flexor retinaculum, which allows certain structures to pass through. Now, first one is the tunnel for flexor carpi radialis tendon. Tunnel for flexor carpi radialis tendon. So that is actually here. And if you go back to my previous image that I shared with you, there also you see the flexor retinaculum like this, and then there is a separate tunnel like that for the flexor carpi radialis tendon. So that is the tunnel we are referring to here. Then more important than that, the other tunnel is the Guyon's canal. You also call it the ulnar tunnel. And here you get that tunnel in that area. Okay, in that area you get that tunnel. So through that tunnel passes the ulnar nerve and the ulnar artery. Ulnar nerve and ulnar artery passes through that tunnel. So this is that tunnel. Okay, so it's called Guyon's canal. And the importance of this is that sometimes the nerve and artery can get compressed in this tunnel. Okay, especially when the nerve is compressed, you get symptoms related to the nerve in relation to the medial aspect of the hand and the medial one and a half fingers. You get numbness, pain, and even sometimes, you know, weakness. So this is your flexor retinaculum. Okay, which is labeled as transverse carpal ligament. It's another name for flexor retinaculum. And this is a different ligament, this volar or palmar carpal ligament, which forms the roof of the Guyon's canal. And you know, you can have, you know, other ligaments forming the floor with the flexor retinaculum. You get this pisohamate ligament. So this is a good diagram actually I got from internet. So anyway, remember this point. Details you don't have to have. Remember this Guyon's canal through which the ulnar nerve and part artery passes in front of the flexor retinaculum, where they can get compressed. Okay. Some of these topics we can revisit during the overview clinical anatomy lecture later. Then this concept of carpal tunnel. Now by now you have an idea about it. Now, if you get the carpal bones, either the proximal row of carpal bones or the distal row of carpal bones. Now, in this case, the section has been taken proximally through the flexor retinaculum. That's why you see the proximal row of carpal bones, epiciform, triquetral, lunate, and scaphoid here. Now, whatever the section you take, whether it's proximal or distal, you can see the carpal bones are arranged like a gutter here. Okay. So, they are arranged forming a gutter within them here, and that is roofed by the flexor retinaculum attached to these bones. So ultimately you get a fibro-osseous tunnel. It's also called osseofacial tunnel or fibro-osseous tunnel. So within that fibro-osseous tunnel, you get the structures that we listed as passing posterior to the flexor retinaculum. Okay, we listed out several structures as passing posterior to the flexor retinaculum. Now, I could not mention when I did the first slide that there's another important structure passing in front of the flexor retinaculum. Just like the palmar cutaneous branch of the ulnar nerve, which is here, there's another palmar cutaneous branch, which is a branch from the median nerve, palmar cutaneous branch of the median nerve. So that becomes clinically important, because that is also given, just like the ulnar nerve giving the palmar cutaneous branch here and passing, both passing superficial to the flexor retinaculum, median nerve, which is here, gives a palmar cutaneous branch. It gives a palmar cutaneous branch. The palmar cutaneous branch passes anterior to the flexor retinaculum, but the median nerve does not pass anterior to the flexor retinaculum like the ulnar nerve. It passes deep to the flexor retinaculum. You can find the median nerve deep to the flexor retinaculum here, whereas the palmar cutaneous branch of the median nerve is superficial to you. So the clinically important point here is that when the pressure increases inside the carpal tunnel and causes carpal tunnel syndrome, the median nerve gets compressed, but the palmar cutaneous branch is not affected. Okay, so that is the point that will become important later. Now, other thing is you get the long flexor tendons passing through it, as we mentioned before. Now, in carpal tunnel syndrome, which is the important point arising from this the theme, because of the fact that I mentioned the palmar cutaneous branch passing anterior, superficial to the flexor retinaculum and supplying the skin over the thenar eminence. Now you have hypothenar muscles here and thenar muscles there. We will discuss it as muscles later. Now this palmar cutaneous branch of the median nerve, since it supplies the skin over the thenar eminence, when the nerve is compressed inside the carpal tunnel, causing carpal tunnel syndrome, there will not be anesthesia in that area. There will not be, okay, don't get it mixed up. So no anesthesia over the hypothenar, over the thenar eminence, because of the palmar cutaneous branch. Okay, no anesthesia. Okay, sometimes students get confused between no and yes. Then it is the median nerve that passes through the carpal tunnel that gives rise to digital nerves that supply the skin of the lateral 3.5 fingers. If you count them, you can see it's lateral 3.5 fingers. So the medial 3.5 fingers is supplied by the ulnar nerve, superficial branch of the ulnar nerve. Now here, it's the lateral 3.5 fingers supplied by the median nerve. Therefore, in carpal tunnel syndrome, when the nerve is compressed, you get anesthesia over this area. Lateral lateral 2/3 of the palm and the lateral 3.5 fingers, okay, including the thumb. But there is no anesthesia over the thenar eminence because the palmar cutaneous branch of the median nerve. Then when it comes to motor functions, now this is the sensory function that we mentioned. When it comes to motor functions, what happens is, since the median nerve is compressed, the motor functions of thenar muscles is affected. Thenar muscles is affected because you can see this is the motor branch of the median nerve, which is called the recurrent motor branch of the median nerve, that supplies the thenar muscles, which is distal to the, that supplies distal to the flexor retinaculum. Your flexor retinaculum is somewhere here. Therefore, the muscles get weaker and weaker, and they can actually become smaller and smaller. You call it atrophy of muscles. Atrophy of muscles. So that is the case. So ultimately, if you summarize it, when the median nerve gets compressed in the carpal tunnel, you get muscles here, the thenar muscles get weak because of lack of nerve supply, but the skin or the thenar muscles is intact. There is no anesthesia there. On the other hand, there is anesthesia over the lateral half or 2/3 of the palm of the hand and the lateral 3.5 fingers, but the movements here in these fingers not affected. You can freely move these ones because the tendons are long tendons coming through the carpal tunnel here, long tendons coming through the carpal tunnel, which receive their nerve supply from the median nerve, but very much proximal to the flexor retinaculum. Somewhere here the nerve supply will come. Therefore, these tendons will have no effect by the compression of the median nerve at this distal point. Okay, so there is movement not affected here, but the sensory affected. The sensory not affected here, but the movements are, the action of muscles affected rather. Okay, so remember this point. So if somebody asks you to describe the signs and symptoms of carpal tunnel syndrome, then you can mention this is, you know, as symptoms, they get pain difficult in holding objects sometimes when it is severe. But as signs, you get this weakness, sensory loss, and sometimes, you know, atrophy of muscles in that area. Okay. Then few things about the palm of the hand and the skin of the palm of the hand. Now, if you take a section of the skin of the palm, you can see that it is very thick. Okay, skin of the palm is very thick. Like in any other place of the skin, you get stratified squamous keratinizing epithelium there with keratin layer. But unlike in other places, at the palm and in the sole of the foot, the skin is very thick. In the sole of the foot, it's much more thicker than the palm of the hand. The important thing is here, you don't get hair in the palm. Okay, if you have hair in the palm, it's a problem. Okay, you don't get hair or hair follicles. Okay, now it's like this. Now you get the hair like this, and you get the hair follicle like this, and you have the sebaceous gland attached to the hair follicle, and that opens into the skin. So since you don't have hair and hair follicles, there is no sebaceous glands also in the skin of the palm. So this is an advantage, because the sebaceous glands, if you remember the action of sebaceous glands, they secrete sebum. Okay, sebum, which is oily. It's an oily secretion. So if you have oil here, that will affect your grip. You want to firmly firmly hold on to things using the hand. So not having sebaceous glands is an advantage for a firm grip. On the other hand, there are many sweat glands. Okay, so these are all sweat glands in the palm, skin of the palm. There are many sweat glands. So the secretion by the sweat glands is a watery secretion. It's a watery secretion. Now, having a very small, very little bit of moisture here, okay, it's not a large amount of fluid, no, it's very little amount of watery fluid here. It actually increases the grip of the palm. You can actually do that experiment. You know, when the palm is dry, sometimes you cannot hold on to something firmly, but having a very having this area wet, actually it increases the grip. But when you have too much of sweat, again you have to wipe it out. That's a different issue. You can do that very easily. Okay, so having too many having many sweat glands also actually help to increase the grip. Then you have this palmaris brevis muscle. In that area, palmaris brevis muscle attached between the flexor retinaculum and the skin. So there is no bony attachment, it's between the flexor retinaculum and the skin. That muscle, it actually wrinkles the skin in this area and helps to hold on to objects easily. So all these points actually, and the point that I could not mention, this skin is not loose. It's very firmly attached to the underlying deep fascia, and there is an aponeurosis called palmar aponeurosis here. Which is a thickening of deep fascia here. So this skin is firmly attached to palmar aponeurosis in the middle and the deep fascia over the thenar and hypothenar muscles. So this whole area is attached to the underlying tissues firmly. Again, you know, skin being not allowed to move freely over the underlying tissue also increases the ability to grip something. Otherwise, you know, it will if there's a relative movement between the skin and the underlying tissues, then again you cannot easily hold on to something, it will fall. Okay, so all these factors will increase the grip of the hand. So remember that point. So there are certain things are actually histological reasons, certain things are gross anatomical reasons, whatever it is, you can just remember that. Then when it comes to the muscles of the hand, you can classify the muscles of the hand into two broad groups, extrinsic muscles of the hand and the intrinsic muscles of the hand. Okay, the extrinsic muscles of the hand, they are actually the long flexor and extensor muscles, which are actually their origin and their muscle belly are in the forearm, actually either on the anterior side or on the posterior side, whether depending on whether they are flexors or extensors, and their insertion is to the hand. So only the insertion is actually on the bones of the head. But when it comes to intrinsic muscles, both the origin and the insertion of the small muscles that we call intrinsic muscles are within the hand. Both origin and the insertion are within the hand. That's why they are called intrinsic muscles. So now this you already know, you have discussed the forearm somewhere, the anterior compartment and the posterior compartment of the forearm. So you must have learned about the extensor muscles of the hand, which are actually forearm muscles. Okay, now we will see what can be included as intrinsic muscles of the hand. So there are several groups, as you can see here, I have grouped them. There are thenar muscles and adductor pollicis muscles. Now, even though adductor pollicis is attached to the thumb, that is not categorized under thenar muscles. So there are three thenar muscles. If you name them, it is flexor pollicis brevis, then abductor pollicis brevis, and opponens pollicis muscles. So these are the three thenar muscles. Then you have adductor pollicis as a separate muscle. Then the three hypothenar muscles. So just like the thenar muscles, you get hypothenar muscles in that area. So your thenar, I don't know whether you can see, your thenar muscles are here, hypothenar muscles are here in relation to the little finger. Thenar muscles are in relation to the thumb. They move the thumb. The hypothenar muscles move the little finger. So you have a flexor digiti minimi, then you have an abductor digiti minimi here, and an opponens digiti minimi. Okay, so there are three hypothenar muscles. Then there are four lumbricals arising from the residuorum profundus tendon. Then there are 3 to 4 palmar interossei and 4 dorsal interossei. Now here, usually you have only 3 palmar interossei, but it's possible to have a fourth one in relation to the thumb. Okay. And then last one is the palmaris brevis, not a very, very main muscle. It's a very small muscle attached between the skin and the flexor retinaculum. So these are the, if somebody asks you to list the intrinsic muscles, these are the intrinsic muscles in the hand. And one point you need to remember is that the lumbricals that I mentioned here, lumbricals and the palmaris brevis muscle, both these groups of muscles have no bony attachments. Okay, so lumbricals actually are attached between the flexor digitorum profundus tendons and the extensor expansion of the fingers. We'll get back to it later. And the palmaris brevis is attached between the skin and the flexor retinaculum. So there is no bony attachment. Remember that point, MCQ point. Okay. Then if you summarize the nerve supply of the muscles of the hand, this is how you can do it. Now, rather than calling these long flexor and extensor muscles, the extrinsic muscles, as long flexors and extensors, I would call them like finger flexors and finger extensors. Now, when the moment I say that finger and, you know, within brackets thumb, flexors and extensors, that will exclude all your carpi muscles that act on the wrist, namely flexor carpi ulnaris, flexor carpi radialis, extensor carpi radialis, longus and brevis, and extensor carpi ulnaris. They are excluded because they do not act on the fingers. They only act on the wrist mainly. Okay, so I purposefully did that because otherwise you will go, the topic will go out of the hand otherwise. Okay, so if you take finger and thumb flexors, so basically flexor digitorum profundus and superficialis and flexor pollicis longus muscles, they are supplied by ulna and median nerves. When you did the forearm, you must have noticed that most of these muscles are supplied by the median nerve in the forearm. Only the medial half of the flexor digitorum profundus is supplied by the ulna nerve in this case. Okay, then if you take the extensors of the fingers and thumb, it is the posterior interosseous nerve. Okay, it is the posterior interosseous nerve that supply all extensors of the thumb and fingers. Then hypothenar muscles here, and all interossei, palmar and dorsal interossei, that means, and the medial 2 lumbricals. So there are 4 lumbricals, 2 lateral lumbricals, and 2 medial lumbricals. You get back to it. And the adductor pollicis. The whole list of these muscles, intrinsic muscles, are supplied by the deep branch of the ulnar nerve. So you can see here, In the forearm, most of the muscles are supplied by the median nerve. And in the hand, most of the intrinsic muscles are supplied by the deep branch of the ulnar nerve. Okay, only few are supplied by the median nerve. And when it comes to the posterior aspect of the forearm, they are all supplied by the posterior interosseous nerve, except few. Few exceptions are there. The extensor, carpi radialis, longus, and you know, you must have learned that when you did that. Okay, then the rest of it, the thenar muscles and the lateral two lumbricals, okay, are supplied by the median nerve. Thenar muscles and lateral two lumbricals are supplied by the median nerve. But the segments, whether they are supplied by the ulnar nerve or the median nerve, the segments are C8 and T1. Segments are C8 and T1. In some cases, T1 is the predominant segment. In some cases, C8 could be the predominant segment. Now, one instance is when it comes to interossei, dorsal and palmar interossei, it is mainly the T1 segment. So, during clinical examinations, when you look for dorsal and palmar interossei by abduction and adduction of fingers, that can be done. What you are checking for, what you are looking for, is the T1 segment rather than C8 segment. Remember that point also. Okay. So this is a nice specimen we got in the anatomy lab. You can see, this is just to show you what I mentioned in the previous slide. Now this is your flexor retinaculum. Okay, so it has been cut in the center to show you the median nerve passing deep to it. Now the long flexor tendons has been reflected. Okay, to make the image clear to you. But you can see this red arrow that I have used here, that shows you the motor recurrent branch of the median nerve that supplies the thenar muscles here. These are the thenar muscles. Okay, so that's why, you know, when you compress the nerve here, there will be thenar muscle weakness. And you can also see these digital nerves coming from the median nerve supplying the lateral three and a half fingers. Then on the other hand, in the same specimen, you can see here the flexor retinaculum, you see the ulnar nerve and ulnar artery here, and the ulnar nerve giving digital branches to lateral the medial one and a half fingers, half of this here, digital branch. Okay, so artery is a different topic. Okay, artery is a different topic, we'll come back to it. So this is a nice specimen. Okay. Okay, then the other point, now this is your flexor retinaculum again, this is your median nerve. Now this is your ulnar nerve and artery. So you can see that the ulnar nerve gives rise to a deep branch here, deep branch and a superficial branch. It's very difficult to make out which one is artery and which one is nerve. So anyway, the artery is actually lateral. Okay, so the artery is on that side. So this should be taken as the nerve in that case, okay, because the artery is lateral. Okay, so this should be the artery, and the nerve has given off to this deep branch, which winds around the hook of the hamate, and comes to a deep layer, and then the superficial branch of the ulnar nerve continues and gives rise to the digital branches to supply the medial 1.5 fingers. So that is the point I wanted to raise there. Then the arteries, on the other hand, give rise to superficial and deep palmar arches. There are arterial arches. Now in this case, you see the superficial palmar arch here, superficial palmar arch. Now in this particular diagram, it's a complete arch. So how the arch is formed is that you get the radial artery here. So look at the radial artery, sorry. So you look at the radial artery here. It gives rise to superficial branch, and then it continues around the thumb metacarpal to the posterior side. So when you take a section, when you took the flexor retinaculum section through the flexor retinaculum, that's why you saw the radial artery on the posterior side. Okay, so you understand. Now the superficial branch of the radial artery continues here in front of the flexor retinaculum here, and it anastomoses with the continuation of the ulnar artery. Okay, the continuation of the ulnar artery. So ulnar artery is here. ulnar artery continues. It also gives a deep branch. Ulnar artery gives a deep branch here, which goes with the deep branch of the ulnar nerve. So that's the deep part. And then the rest of the ulnar artery continues here. So the continuation of the ulnar artery here can anastomose with the superficial branch of the radial artery and can form the superficial palmar arch. And when that happens, it becomes a complete arch. But in some people, maybe in majority of the cases, you don't get a superficial branch of the radial artery. Okay, the radial artery will just continue like that without giving a superficial branch. Therefore, the superficial palmar arch stops here. Okay, like that, incomplete. So that becomes an incomplete arch because there is no superficial branch from the radial artery. That is the usual case. Okay, so remember that point also is usually incomplete. And that palmar arch will give rise to the common palmar digital arteries and then the digital artery. So that's a different tissue. Okay, then now this superficial palmar arch, as you can see here, it's an incomplete one. It stops here. Can you see? It's only the ulnar artery that forms it. Okay. So on the other hand, the deep palmar arch, which lies only anterior to the metacarpal bones and the interossei, deep to all the long flexor tendons, that is formed by the deep branch of the radial artery and the continuation of the radial artery, which actually you can see this dotted line here, because that does not come in front of the thumb, it comes behind the thumb, and re-enter the palm here. Okay. So then that will form the deep palmar arch. Unlike the superficial palmar arch, deep palmar arch is usually complete. Okay, it's, most of the time it's a complete arch. It's not incomplete. Okay. And the other thing is, if you look at the deep branch of the ulnar nerve that supply most of the intrinsic muscles, it actually lies proximal to this one. They lie very close to each other, proximal to the deep palmar arch, not distal. Okay, not there, but proximal to the deep palmar arch. Okay, few things about palmar spaces. Now, your palmar aponeurosis, which is an expansion of the palmaris longus tendon. Palmaris longus is a muscle here. So this tendon expands and forms what is called palmar aponeurosis. And this palmar aponeurosis has its apex towards the wrist and the base towards the proximal end of the fingers. Now, the palmar aponeurosis, there are two fibrous septa, one arising from the lateral edge of the palmar aponeurosis, other one arising from the medial edge of the palmar aponeurosis. Okay, so that is called lateral septum. This one is the lateral septum and this one is the medial septum. Then these two septa, they are attached. Now the lateral one is attached to, I'll show you the position of the metacarpal bones. Now this is the third metacarpal bone, the metacarpal bone of the middle finger here, this one. And this is the fifth metacarpal bone. This is the level of the fifth metacarpal bone, this line. So these two septa are attached to these metacarpal bones. Lateral one is attached to the third metacarpal bone and the medial one is attached to the fifth metacarpal bone. So by looking at this, you can see that you can understand that they are oblique, therefore. So your, if I take a section like this, if this is your palmar aponeurosis and this is the lateral side and this is the medial side, this is your the third metacarpal bone, and if this is your fifth metacarpal bone. So the lateral septum is attached like this and the medial septum is attached like that, something like that. Okay, so it's oblique. Okay, it's not like this. So then whatever it is, so this medial and lateral septa, which are dipping down from the medial and lateral edges of the palmar aponeurosis, divides the palm into three spaces. So lateral to the lateral septum, that area is called the thenar space. Then medial to the medial septum is called the hypothenar space. Then between the two septa, you get the mid palmar space. You get the mid palmar space. Now, even though, you know, it's we simply define it like that, since there are several structures, especially long flexor tendons, passing through, especially through the mid palmar space, you don't get a space as such there. You only get a potential space. Sometimes it's occupied by many other structures, so the actual space is much smaller than you expect. So don't get confused. Okay. And the other point is this hypothenar space is totally occupied by the hypothenar muscles. Hypothenar space is fully occupied by the hypothenar muscles, and there are no tendons passing through it. Through the thenar space and mid palmar space, long flexor tendons are passing with their synovial sheets. We'll get back to it. Therefore, they are clinically important. This one and this one are clinically important, but the hypothenar space is clinically insignificant. Since it is clinically insignificant, you know that you are going to become doctors, so you will not talk about hypothenar space too much. When the questions are asked in the exams, if you are asked to describe palmar spaces, the weightage given to hypothenar space is very little in the marking schemes, because that space is clinically not very important. Remember that point. Okay, so even at postgraduate exams, it is like that. Okay, so these are the spaces then. You have the thenar space, then the hypothenar space and mid palmar space. As you can see here, all the tendons are passing in that area. Okay, so this area becomes clinically insignificant therefore. Okay, and some tendons are even passing here. So as I mentioned before, you can see this is the lateral septum, this is the medial septum. So thenar space is lateral to the lateral septum, hypothenar space is medial to the medial septum, mid palmar space is between the two septa. Okay. Then this is from Richard Snell again, this diagram. This is to show you the actual, the existing spaces. So hypothenar space, we will not take into consideration. When it comes to thenar space, you can see the thenar space here. This blue area is the thenar space. It actually lies between the adductor pollicis muscle posteriorly and the long flexor tendons to the index finger. Long flexor tendons to the index finger. You have two tendons now, flexor digitorum profundus and superficialis tendons. So between these two, you get the flexor pollicis longus, all these three tendons. Okay. So between the adductor pollicis and the long flexor tendons to the index finger and thumb, you get the thenar space, and the structure lying in that space is actually the first lumbrical. Okay, first lumbrical, which is attached to the extensor expansion of the index finger. So first lumbrical is the content of the thenar space. Similarly, the mid palmar space, as you can see here, mid palmar space, again shown with this blue area, that lies between the long flexor tendons anteriorly here, covered with synovial sheets, and the interosseous muscles and the metacarpal bones posteriorly. Okay, so it's again a small area, smaller than you expect, and the structures lying in it are the second, third, and fourth lumbrical muscles. But the point here is this: since the space is immediately related to the flexor tendons here and here in both cases, if there's infection in the synovial sheets of flexor tendons, you call it synovial sheath inflammation, synovitis. When you get synovitis, you can easily spread that infection into the mid palmar space in relation to these tendons, or in relation to these tendons, if the synovial sheath are infected, infection can easily spread into the thenar space. Okay. And the other point is, when the infection spreads into the thenar space and hypothenar space, that infection can go distally again into the web spaces, or if there's infection in the web spaces, can come into these spaces through the lumbrical muscles, which lie in what are called lumbrical canals. I'll show you in a different slide. Okay, it's rather, you know, going in that direction than, you know, going in this direction than going in that direction. Okay, so it's from distal to proximal. Okay, I'll get back to it. Okay, so diagrammatically, this is how you can represent it. So this is the first lumbrical These three are the second, third, and fourth lumbricals. And these lumbricals, actually, they pass through what are called lumbrical canals. They pass through lumbrical canals because if your fingers are like this, lumbricals are here in the palm, they have to get attached to the extensor expansion like that. So they pass through these lumbrical canals here. Okay. So the issue is, now you have web spaces between the fingers. Okay. When there's infection in the web spaces, infection can spread through the lumbrical canals surrounding the lumbrical muscles and can enter the mid palmar space or thenar space. So that is the clinical point there. Then this fibrous flexor sheath, just like the flexor retinaculum and extensor retinaculum, to hold the long flexor tendons without allowing them to jut out during flexion of interphalangeal joints, these fibrous flexor sheaths keep the tendons in place, forming fibro-osseous tunnels. Now that you have the bone here, okay, in a cross section, these are the fibrous flexor sheaths. So that is called a fibro-osseous tunnel. Therefore, inside the fibro-osseous tunnel, you get the flexor digitorum, profundus, and superficialis tendons together. Then, since it is a fibro-osseous tunnel, when you move these tendons all the time, there will be a lot of frictional forces operating there. Then to reduce those frictional forces, their tendons are not there. What happens is the tendons are covered with a very nicely packed synovial sheath. So this is a very nice synovial sheath filled with very small amount of synovial fluid. So there will be a lot of lubrication there, and it prevents frictional forces between the fibrosis tunnel and the tendon. So these are the synovial sheaths. Then your digital nerves and vessels, they pass on either side of the fibrous flexor sheaths here. You can see here, they lie on either side of the finger. Then about the synovial sheaths, little bit more details about the synovial sheath. Now this is your metacarpophalangeal joints, the fingers. You can see when it comes to the index, middle and ring finger, they have synovial sheaths starting from the beginning of the tendon, long flexor tendons, and ending just proximal to the metacarpophalangeal joints. You can see here, metacarpophalangeal joints. If you bend your palm, you do that for yourself and see. If you bend your metacarpophalangeal joints here, actually you can see that the metacarpophalangeal joint lies somewhere. It lies actually in the area of the palm, behind that area. Okay, so then you can easily detect where the metacarpophalangeal joints in relation to the palm when you do that. So it's somewhere here, metacarpophalangeal joints. Okay, so the synovial sheaths, as you can see here, if the metacarpophalangeal joints are there, then the synovial sheaths will come further proximally, somewhere here. Okay, somewhere there the synovial sheaths will end according to this, if you compare it with your palm and the diagram here. So this is metacarpophalangeal joints. So your palm is actually somewhere here. Okay, palm is somewhere here like that. Okay, so then you can see that the three synovial sheaths of index, middle and ring finger, they stop proximal to the metacarpophalangeal joints, and then there is a bare area of the tendons there. There's a gap. But when it comes to the flexor pollicis longus synovial sheath, which is a totally separate synovial sheath, from the beginning to the end, there's a continuation of the synovial sheath. There's no bare area of the tendon. It passes through the carpal tunnel, and also it is there in the proximal or the distal part of the forearm. It enters the forearm area as well, okay, passing through the carpal tunnel. Similarly, the synovial sheath of the little finger, as you can see, there is no bare area again. It is a continuous sheath, okay, right up to the, again, the distal end of the forearm passing through the carpal tunnel. Then the other important point is, in the palm, this synovial sheath of the little finger forms a common synovial sheath together with the index, middle and ring finger tendons. Okay, so ultimately what you get is a continuation of synovial sheath of the little finger forming a common sheath for other three fingers as well as this one together here. The flexor pollicis one is actually separate. So then this common synovial sheath is the one that you detected when you did the cross section in the first few slides of the lecture. So when you take section like this, you will see this as a separate synovial sheath and this as a common synovial sheath for both profundus and superficialis tendons. Okay. Then this one is called ulna bursa. When you say ulna bursa, the whole area. Okay, so this is also ulna bursa. So this whole thing is called the ulna bursa and this is called the radial bursa. Ulna bursa and radial bursa, these are just, you know, two different names. Don't get confused. And in about 50% of the cases, this even though in this diagram they are separate, there is a communication between the radial bursa and ulna bursa somewhere in the palm. Okay. There's a communication. So if there's an infection here, that can spread to this one. If there's infection coming through this, that can spread to this one also. Okay. And the lumbricals actually take origin from these bare areas of the tendons, except for this one. There is no bare area, but there's thinning of the synovial sheath where the lumbrical takes origin from. So the four lumbricals take origin from the four flexor digitorum profundus tendons in these areas and is attached to the extensor expansion there. If you put the fibrous flexor sheaths on top of this, that will cover the synovial sheaths. These are fibrous flexor sheaths. They also end just proximal to the metacarpal phalangeal joints, looking all fingers and thumb. Then if you overlap this diagram with the palmar aponeurosis in green color, this is your palmar aponeurosis. And the palmar aponeurosis has, you know, you can see 1, 2, 3, 4 slips. It divides into 4 slips distally, and each slip further divides into 2 smaller slips, which are attached on either side of the base of the proximal phalanges. Okay, and through these slips of palmar aponeurosis, you can see the lumbrical muscles. Still, you can see the lumbrical muscles. So they are actually passing through the lumbrical canals, as I said, to enter the web spaces. So these are your web spaces. Okay. So if you hold your finger like this, your metacarpal phalangeal joints are somewhere here. So then this area is the skin, free skin. This area is the web space. From the metacarpal phalangeal joints up to the free skin here. So you get these three web spaces. Okay, first, second, and third web spaces. So lumbricals, so if there's infection here, the clinical point is infection can spread into the mid palmar space through the lumbrical canals. Okay. So further superficial to the palmar aponeurosis, there is what is called transverse metacarpal ligament and deep to all the long flexor tendons, deep to all these structures, lumbricals and long tendons, you get a deep transverse metacarpal ligament. I did label it deep transverse metacarpal ligament. Now this is a good diagram to show you the arrangement of these structures. If you take a cross section of the hand, if your hand is like this, if you cut it like that in a cross section, this is how you see the structures from superficial to deep. You have the skin here, then you have the superficial transverse metacarpal ligament, which is just deep to the skin here. Then you get the long tendons covered with their synovial sheaths, deep to the superficial transverse metacarpal ligament. Then you have the digital nerves and vessels. Then you have the digital slips of palmar aponeurosis. Okay. So all deep to the superficial metacarpal, transverse metacarpal ligament. Then the deep transverse metacarpal ligament is deep to all that. Okay. In other words, all these long tendons, slips of palmar aponeurosis, digital nerves and vessels, lumbricals, they all lie between the superficial and deep transverse metacarpal ligaments. If someone says that in an MCQ or somewhere, that is true. Okay. They lie between the two transverse metacarpal ligaments. Then only posterior to the transverse metacarpal ligament, deep transverse metacarpal ligament, you have the interossei and the metacarpal bones, the 5 metacarpal bones and the interossei lying between them. Okay, so that gives you a good orientation of the thing. Okay, even though the time has passed, we will continue. Now about the lumbricals and interossei, As you can see in this diagram, the lumbricals, now this is the flexor digitorum profundus tendon, so this is the lumbrical. Therefore, lumbrical is attached to the extensor expansion formed by the expansion of the tendons of the long extensor muscles. That is called extensor expansion or extensor hood. You can also call it extensor hood. Now, lumbricals are attached to the extensor hood. They have no bony attachment, I told you. On the other hand, the interosseous muscles, both palmar and dorsal interossei, they have two attachments. They are attached to the extensor expansion as well as the proximal, the base of the proximal phalanx. Base of the proximal phalanx. But their actions are the same. What they do is because of this force, they flex the metacarpophalangeal joints. So here they flex it. So that is actually similar to the action of long flexors. Okay. Then because of this action, which is similar to the extensor digitorum action, they extend the interphalangeal joints. Okay, so they extend interphalangeal joints. So the ultimate action is this. This is how you remember it. They flex the metacarpophalangeal joints and extend the interphalangeal joints. Now, flexion of the metacarpophalangeal joints is due to the force coming in front of the palm. The extension of the interphalangeal joints is due to the force passing behind the fingers through the extensor expansion. So it's a common action for interossei and lumbricals. Then interossei have got other actions. Some interossei actually abduct the fingers. Some interossei adduct the fingers. Okay, the palmar interossei, they adduct. Dorsal interossei, they abduct. So that's an additional action of interossei other than this flexion of metacarpophalangeal joints and extension of interphalangeal joints. Okay, don't get confused. Okay, now in this diagram, you can actually see this is a very nicely dissected lumbrical. It starts from the tendon here. You can see flexor digital profundus. This is the extensor expansion actually. Okay, so all are shown with the arrows. The green arrow shows the lumbrical and the yellow arrow shows the extensor expansion. So there is no bony attachment. You can faintly see the interosseous there. I'll show you. Okay, in this diagram, it's clear. This is the extensor expansion shown with the yellow arrow. And the green arrow shows the lumbrical and the red arrow shows the interosseous. Remember that the interosseous has an attachment to the extensor expansion as well as the base of the proximal phalanx. Now, this is how you remember the action of palmar and dorsal interossei. Palmar interossei, you remember as PAD. PAD means palmar adduction. Palmar adduction. Then the dorsal interossei are remembered as DEB. DEB means dorsal abduction. Okay. Palmar adduction and dorsal abduction. Because it's palmar adduction. Now, if you take the four fingers like this, adduction is this. Now, here the center is taken as the middle finger. There's no other way, you know. Therefore, the middle finger cannot be further adducted. Okay, so there are no adductors to the middle finger. So there are no palmar interossei to the middle finger. But you have a palmar interosseus to the little finger. Okay. And there's a palmar interosseus to the ring finger. And there's a palmar interosseus to the index finger. Now, you don't need a palmar interosseus to the thumb because there is a adductor pollicis, separate adductor. But in some people, you do get a separate palmar interosseus to the thumb, making the number of palmar interossei 4. Otherwise, it's 3 adductors. In this diagram, you can only see 3 actually. Okay. But remember that there is no palmar interossei to the middle finger because there is no way that you can adduct it further. It's in the middle. Okay. Going by the same rule, when it comes to dorsal interossei, that side, okay, dorsal interossei, they abduct. So when it comes to abduction, the middle finger can be abducted in either direction. Index finger can be abducted that way, ring finger can be abducted that way, and the little finger can be abducted that way. Now, this one will have the first dorsal interosseus. Therefore, this one will have the second and third to abduct that side and this side, and ring finger will have the fourth dorsal interosseus. Little finger, even though it can be abducted, there is no dorsal interosseus for that. It has its own abductor digiti minimi. Okay, it has its own abductor digiti minimi for its abduction here. Okay, its own abductor digiti minimi. Okay, so this is how you remember the palmar and dorsal interossei. So usually you get therefore four dorsal interossei muscles. And as I told you before, all palmar and dorsal interossei, they are supplied by the deep branch of the ulnar nerve, and it is mainly T1 segment. It is mainly T1 segment. And when you look for the abduction and adduction action of interossei, actually what you do is, you keep, now if this is a table, you keep the hand of the patient on the table. If I show you the table now, this is, you keep it like this, and you ask them to abduct and adduct, so that, you know, they lie on the same surface. Otherwise, you do this and do abduction and adduction. Okay, so then you can abduct and adduct, and you can put a piece of paper in between the fingers so that you can ask the person to hold it by adduction firmly, and you pull it. You pull it like this. Okay, so I'll try to do it. So you have a paper like this. You ask the person to put the hand on the table and try to adduct, and you pull it. You pull it. If the person cannot hold it for some extent, then that means the adductors are weak. So that actually gives you an idea about the action of the interossei, as well as the integrity of the nerve, deep branch of the ulnar nerve. Then a few points about the snuff box, the anatomical snuff box. Again, there's a clinical importance there. The anatomical snuff box is a triangular shaped area. So this is the anatomical snuff box area. It's a triangular shaped area. You can see the boundaries. There are three borders, floor and a roof. The three borders are formed by the, now if you are in the anatomical position, if you think of it as the anatomical position, laterally you get the abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis tendons. If it is held like this, then medially you get the extensor pollicis longus tendon. Then the base is formed by the distal part of the styloid, the styloid process of the radius. Okay, styloid process of the radius. So that's how the triangle is formed. Then the roof is formed by the skin, and the floor is formed by four bony points. Again, you can add radial styloid here if you want. Then the scaphoid, trapezium, and the base of the thumb metacarpal. Okay, so if you put the four bony points, they are like that, base of the thumb metacarpal. So now the important structure here is the scaphoid. Now the scaphoid that is here in the anatomical snuff box, that is the bone that can get fractured when you fall on the outstretched hand. When you fall on the outstretched hand, scaphoid can get fractured and it can go undetected. Okay, now when you take x-rays, say if there's a history of falling on the outstretched hand, and there's a fracture of say forearm bones or humerus or whatever, or dislocation, you should always look for tenderness. That is, you know, tenderness means when you press with your finger, you can elicit pain here. When you press the anatomical snuff box, if there is severe tenderness here, you suspect scaphoid fracture. Now the issue with scaphoid fracture is that the scaphoid gets its blood supply. Now if this is the proximal limb and this is the distal limb, it gets its blood supply like this from the distal limb. Okay, so when it is fractured like this across this proximal half of the fractured bone, gets ischemic. Ischemic means it does not get blood supply. So distal half remains, proximal half undergo avascular necrosis, ischemic necrosis, and you know that can give rise to continuous pain, chronic pain of the hand during all movements. So it's very problematic. So you should detect it early. So in such cases, you should immediately take a hand x-ray and look for fracture of the scaphoid. You type in the internet scaphoid fracture, x-ray scaphoid fracture, you will get very beautiful images of the scaphoid fractured. Okay, so for that reason, anatomical snuff box becomes important. That's one reason for its importance. Then other than that, you should know that the radial artery actually passes through it. So it comes from this side, we mentioned it, then winds around the thumb metacarpal. So it passes through the anatomical snuff box. You can feel for arterial pulse here in the anatomical snuff box. Then here it re-enters the palm after winding around the thumb metacarpal to form the deep palmar arterial arch. Okay, deep palmar arterial arch. Then the other contents of the anatomical snuff box are the cephalic vein. It's the commencement of the cephalic vein from the dorsal venous arch here. Then you get the branches of the superficial branch of the radial nerve. There are several of them. Okay. So those are the contents of the anatomical snuff box. Okay. I think that brings us to the end of this lecture.